to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. Lord, let's establish the truth right off the bat. We have not come into this house to hear from a man. We have not come into this house to hear from a woman. We really don't give a flip what men have to say. We want to know, God, what you have to say. So we know the teacher of the church is the Holy Spirit. He only uses men and women and people to communicate what you have to say. And so therefore, welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, and motivate us to be all that the Father desires us to be, all that the Son paid the price for us to be, and all that the Holy Spirit empowers us to be. And God, we'll give you the praise, give you the glory, give you the honor. You know, Lord, we pray over every church by denomination all the time. I'm not doing that today. I'm just asking you to bless all the churches that are preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers and our sisters. Bless them as you would bless us. In Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, we all say amen. Get your Bibles and go with me. The title of the message is The Unusual Path to Blessings, found in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. Hasn't Hebrews, the 11th chapter, been just phenomenal? I mean, it's really a faith building, but it's also not just simple faith. It's really about getting in the depths of our hearts. And Hebrews, the 11th chapter, Luke, like I mentioned earlier, did such a great job at verse number 17. It was probably one of the best messages you'll ever hear in your life. If you haven't got it, you ought to download it. It's free. If you want to go to the CD counter, you can buy one there and listen to it over and over again as you drive to work. I really suggest that. It's an amazing message about being tested. Is this a test? And so I want you to get a hold of verse number 17. And as we read this verse aloud, let me explain something as we look at the verse together. Is that okay? So listen closely. By faith, Abraham. You know, the Bible talks about Abraham a lot. In the Old Testament, it talks about Abraham a lot. In the New Testament, it talks about Abraham a lot. Abraham is a very important person as an example of somebody who followed God. And somebody who heard the voice of the Lord and did what God would have him to do. And he is really exalted in Scripture, all through the Scripture. Old Testament as well as in the New Testament. And he says this about Abraham, which is fascinating. When he was tested, Pastor Luke talked about that. And sometimes we zero in on testing. God, can I just say this? God is going to test you. You may not like it. But you know, words are cheap and God knows that. He's known humanity since the beginning. We say a lot of stuff and don't really mean it. We say a lot of stuff and don't really do it. We say a lot of stuff waiting for someone to hear it, but we don't really find it. And therefore, words have become cheap. In business, we used to say this, you know, put your money where your mouth is. Does anybody remember that? Put your money where your mouth is. In Christendom, we say this, you know, put your action where your heart is. It can't just be something, if you will, you know, that you say. And there's a test going to take place. And oftentimes, this verse comes along and makes two statements besides being tested. The statement is obedience, and the statement is sacrifice. Notice what the rest of the verse has to say. Offers up Isaac, and he who had received the promise, that's Abraham. God promised him a son at 100 years old, his only begotten son, his only son, the one he loved with all of his heart. He receives Abraham, how excited he was. And then he says these words. He says, he offered up his only begotten son. It changed everything. So we see obedience and we see sacrifice. A lot of times people don't want to hear about sacrifice. Not all the time is God asking you to sacrifice. But did you know that everything that you'll ever be came because of a sacrifice? Someone paid the price for it. And in our case, if you're saved, Jesus is the one who sacrificed. He said, Lord, not my will, but yours. If this cup could pass from me, I'll let that happen. But he says, Lord, it's not mine. I want yours. I want you to do this, Father. And all of a sudden, we see that sacrifice goes to the cross, a beaten, bloody mess. In other words, he does something. The Father gives up his only begotten Son, whom he loved because it needed to happen. It wasn't just cheap words. It wasn't just talking. He actually fulfilled what needed to be done. And just like the Father in heaven gives up his only begotten son, Jesus, for you and I, here we see this great man, Abraham, doing exactly the same thing. Now, I doubt it very much if God's gonna ever ask you to have that kind of a sacrifice, but he is gonna ask you to be obedient to the place of sacrifice. Sacrifice means this: giving up your ideas, your want, your will for the betterment of someone else. We call that love around here. Yeah, love. If you were to define the word love, I mean, guy, well, define it. Here's how to define the word love. The word love: personal self-sacrifice, the giving of oneself for the betterment of someone else. In other words, if you're not willing to give of yourself, you'll never have a good marriage until you personally sacrifice, because not everybody's just going to go along with what you want, not your ideas and your thinking. And so in order to love, even in a marriage, you're gonna have to be a person that's willing to give up your thinking, your ideas, your philosophies, your want, your will. How much more with God? So all of a sudden we see something taking place right here in this verse number 17. And it's an amazing thing. When there's testing, oftentimes it'll incorporate obedience, number one, and number two, it'll also incorporate the word sacrifice. It's really quite fascinating. As I mentioned earlier, in the New Testament as well as the Old Testament, Abraham is talked about oftentimes, and so we can learn something. And I want to share something with you before we go too much further about what Abraham did. Let me say it again. Are you listening? What Abraham did in order to catch the heart of God that makes him so special. Because if I know that, then therefore I can also, when I hear the voice of the Lord about my own personal life, do the same thing that will catch the heart of God, makes him special. In other words, he's on this unusual path of blessing. And today we're gonna look at some things, but I wanna take you, if I may, into James, the second chapter of James. Just a few pages back in your Bible, go there with me. James, a lot of people don't know this, is a half-brother of Jesus. Yep, half-brother, different fathers. He is a senior pastor of the church, great church of Jerusalem. In the 18th verse, he starts to talk about a biblical principle. And in this principle, listen to this, he's going to use Abraham of what we just read as an example. So therefore, we can learn something about what Abraham did on his unusual path to blessings. You know as well as I do, you want blessings. Amen. I'm going to try to say that again. You know as well as I know, you want the blessings. Ah, let me try this side. You know as well as I know that you want the blessings. Amen. See, and if you really want the blessings, you're gonna have to learn how to do what catches the very heart of God to bring the blessings. Look, just like you love your children if you're a parent, just like you want the very best for them, you would give them anything for the very best. You'd sacrifice your own self for them. But yet at the same time, you wouldn't give it to them if they wasted it. You wouldn't give it to them if they were to throw it away. You wouldn't give it to them if they didn't know how to handle it. Can I say something about blessings that you want? Listen closely, every one of us want them. So listen to this. If you don't know how to handle them, the blessings that you want become a curse. How many people have won the lotto and they're absolutely a mess? More have failed than have made it because they don't know how to handle it. And the truth be said, my friends, is that we want the blessings, but we want a shortcut to get them. You know, many times I'll walk through the courtyard, I was telling the people, through the courtyard, so many people come up to me and say, "Oh, Father, bless me." First of all, I ain't your father. I'm too old to be your father. I might be grandpa. And then, you know, they're coming out of a background where instead of being blessed by doing what God says, they want to shortcut it by having someone just pray over them and hopefully they're going to get blessed. Can I tell you something? This church is not filled with superstitious and foolish thinking. You know what I mean? I'll be happy to pray for you to get blessed, but you're going to have to do something about getting blessed. You're not going to sit back, wait for it, and put the response back. Well, God, he prayed for me. I didn't get blessed. It's his fault, not mine. So all of us have to get into this place where we realize there's something we're going to have to do. And Abraham did something to catch the very heart of God in order for him to get blessed. But in order to understand what it was that he did, let's go to James 2nd chapter, start verse number 18. I'll pop it up on the overhead for you. Let's read it and let's understand it together. Come on, give me your attention. Let's go. No daydreaming in here today at all. Is that okay? If I find you daydreaming, I'm gonna run down the aisle and smack you right in the face. Is that okay? Say it's okay. All right, because now you know you're not gonna daydream. Okay, no daydreaming. We're gonna find out what the Word of God has to say today. This is, why am I fighting for your souls right now? Because this is really important. It's the Bible. Are you following me? America wouldn't be so screwed up right now if somebody taught them the Bible from the beginning, you know? So don't be stupid like other people and just sit there and stare at me like a cow facing a new gate in the yard or something, you know? I did my superstition. I went to church. I guess I would get blessed. You're not going to get blessed. You're not even going to get to heaven until you start to learn how to do this. You got to do it God's way. This is not about doing it my way or some preacher's way. It's about doing it God's way. We're learning how to do things God's way. Are you listening to me? Now, let me just say this to you before I read. What makes Abraham so phenomenal is he didn't know God's way. Think about it. He didn't have a Bible. He didn't have thousands of years of experience of the Word of God. He didn't even know. Did you know that Abraham, he wasn't the first Jew. He was the first Hebrew believer. Judah hadn't even come into existence yet. That's where Jews come from, is Judah. And him coming into existence, he was the first person that ever heard the voice. He didn't say, wow, let me check out what you're saying to me by the scripture. He didn't have scripture. And yet he's being told to do something by God that is absolutely mind-boggling and earth-shaking to his life. Totally contrary to his thinking, totally against his will, totally against his plan. And how in the world is he ever gonna do this? Except there is a principle found here, and Abraham is used as the example of that principle that you and I could get a hold of. But you're not gonna get it if you're gonna be daydreaming on me. Are you listening now? If someone starts to talk to you during the message, just slap him. It's too important for this. Watch this. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. Now, I don't know, I highlighted it for you. I don't know if you noticed it or not. Three times the word works is used. If you don't understand the biblical principle of works, you'll get caught up in a foolish lie that says you can't work your way to heaven, the things you do is not important, and that's biblically unsound and a naive approach to the scripture. Let me tell you and give you and define for you, if I may, and I'll come back to the verse in just a moment. Let me define for you the word works. Works defined as this. What a man does because of his belief. In other words, what you do because you believe. Doesn't matter what you think, it's way beyond that. Doesn't matter what you feel, doesn't matter what you want, doesn't matter what you see. What you do, and that's the test, because you believe it. And when you believe greater than your feelings, greater than your want, greater than your desire, greater than your plan, and you believe in his plan, his feelings, his want, his desire, his way, his will, all of a sudden, life starts to change. Now, so here's the improper, if you will, and I want to say it like this, the wrong interpretation of the word works. What a man does because of tradition, ritual and ceremonial functions. And that's really not works at all. It's really called religion. Are you following me? In other words, we do what we do because someone told us to do it, not because it's in our heart to do it and we're believing it. Someone says, you got to stop that. I'll give you an illustration. You can't do that as a Christian. You're not supposed to do that. Kind of stop it. You just do everything you can and you can't stop it. And finally, you stop it. You stop it because someone told you it wasn't in your heart, but you did it because it was in your flesh and not from your heart. That's religion. And a wrong interpretation is this: you can't work your way into heaven, but you can't have faith that's going to be perfected to get you to heaven until you believe God so much that you're believing him unto righteousness, and you're past where you're at, but you go on. Because what a man believes, that's what he does. And it's just that simple. So something that Abraham believed was believing greater than what the request was of God. And when he believed greater than the request of God, what he was requesting, God was requesting, was something that he just simply would do. Let's take a look at the verse again. Verse 18, go, jump back up there. It says, but someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Now the works there is, as a man believes, that's what he does, okay? He says this, show me your faith without your works. And what he's really saying is, you can't show me your faith without your works, because he says these words, and I will show you my faith by my works. In other words, you will say it. It's not just a word. It is an action behind what I believe. It's not just cheap words. It is an action. It's a lifestyle. It is what I'm working for. It's what I want to do, is getting into this because God said something about it. I believe it. I'm going to do it because God said it. And that's it. Because as a man believes, that's what he does. And he says, I will show you my faith. You'll see my faith by what I believe and do. Watch this. Verse, now right before we get to verse number 19, let me show you something nutty. This subject goes on for the next number of verses. In the middle of this suggestion, this not suggestion, in the middle of these words is verse 19, which is nuts. Out of the blue, he makes a statement. After he says these, I'll show you my faith by my works, verse 19 comes and says this, bang. You believe that there is one God. Yay, you do good, that's great. But then he comes along and says, but even the demons believe and tremble. What the heck's that got to do with works and faith? Here's what's really being said. You start off believing in God, that's great. But all of a sudden, if you're not gonna back up what you're believing with your lifestyle, and produce what God wants you to produce, then you better start trembling, because judgment is coming. Because your faith isn't gonna work by itself without getting in and doing something. So he uses demons. What are demons? Do they believe that there's a God? Yes. Do they believe in Jesus Christ? Yes. Then why do they tremble? Because they don't have the ability to do the job. They don't have the ability to do the works. Therefore, they know what the judgment is, and they're trembling for that day when judgment comes. You and I have the ability to not only have faith in God, but also to follow up with what we believe and a lifestyle on how we act. Come on, somebody. Now, when you get saved, you're immediately washed by the blood. Immediately, you're with Christ. Immediately, you're in the right, at the right hand of God. Immediately, it's called, you are saved. You're there. You're justified. You're sanctified. But did you know you're still living in the flesh? And it still speaks to you. Romans, the 7th chapter, tells us all about Paul. Paul the apostle had problems with his flesh. I do those things that I don't want to do, but I keep doing them all the time. Who will deliver me from? And Jesus Christ. Well, guess what? It's a progressional sanctification when it comes to your flesh. Spiritually, when you receive Jesus Christ, you're sanctified. But the rest of your physical body, it's a progressional. You're working it out as long as you're living on this earth, learning how to do his will, his way, his want, his desires, and his plan instead of your own. Is anybody listening? And that's why he says this. He says, even the demons believe, and they, well, that's good. They're not getting saved because they can't produce the works. So they tremble at the judgment that's coming their way. Is anybody listening? Are you all there? You got it so far? Because I'm taking it to verse number 20. Are you ready for verse number 20? Yes. What? Are you ready for verse number 20? Yes. Okay, you got it so far. Watch verse number 20. But do you want to know you know what he just said? Can I translate this in San Bernardino language? Do you want to know, stupid? That's what he's saying. Do you want to just stay stupid all your life, or do you want to know how to do something? And he makes this question. Do you want to know, stupid, that faith without works is dead? I didn't have all the faith in the world, but I'm putting any action behind it. Can I tell you something? I don't have faith at all. The Bible says it's what? Dead. So words are cheap. What you do says where you're really at. Words are cheap, but what you do says where you're really at. You say, well, I believe in God, but I still do those bad things. Guess what? But are you doing something to get rid of them? Are you believing in the power of the Holy Spirit that lives on the inside of you? And when they come up and you know they're wrong, are you saying, Holy Spirit, thank you for teaching me never to do this again? I had a lot of bad habits, still have a lot of bad habits. Ask Debbie, don't I? Debbie, say yes. I have a lot of bad habits, and guess what? I'm learning how to get rid of them. It's really cool. But really, I'm right. If God comes right now, I'm okay with him because I'm sanctified by instantaneously, but it's a progressional sanctification. He's working on my flesh. And that's why he writes to us in the scripture over and over and over again. It's amazing. Now, some people come along and tell you, you know, you got grace, you don't have to do anything. Can I tell you something that's the biggest lie in the world? You got grace, you don't have to do anything. Like Paul says, I've got freedom, but I can do whatever I want to do. And that's true. But he says, not everything I do is good. Don't you want to do what's right? So guess what? Along with my faith comes what? Comes along an action, comes along ability. So you go talk to those people that are really into big grace stuff. You know what? Can I tell you something? And you throw the book of James. By the way, you can throw Romans and 1 Corinthians and Galatians and a whole bunch of other. But if you just take the book of James and throw it at them and say, what about this? And they say, oh, it's not for us. What do you mean it's not for you? Oh, it was written to the Gnostics. It wasn't really written to the church. Can I tell you something? Who are you to decide what's in the Bible, what's in the not in the Bible? May I tell you this? If you're part of one of those churches, you ought to run for your life. They are wrong with their immature evaluation of Scripture. The Word says it. That's what I believe. Don't be stupid. My goodness, there's a lot of stupid people out there. That's what he says. Faith without works is dead. I can say that because that verse says it. You know what I'm saying? Verse number 21. Is anybody ready for 21? 21 is pretty good. Verse number 21. Oh, was not Abraham. We're back to Abraham. Now watch this as an example. Was not Abraham our father, father of faith? Watch this. Justified by his faith. Didn't say that at all. He was justified by God because he had faith that was followed up by what he did, because a man does what he believes. Amen. Is anybody listening? And when he offered Isaac, his son, to the altar, verse 22, do you see that faith was working together with his works? And by works, what does that mean? What a man does because of his belief. By works, faith was made. Faith was made. Perfect. Oh, come on. Faith was made what?
Perfect.
So does that mean it's not perfect unless? I didn't say that. If I wrote this, I would get the royalties from the Bible. Oh, would I be rich? I'd give you all a lot of money. I didn't write this. In other words, what he makes a statement of, he says, if I really believe this, I ought to do something about it. And what he's asking you to do, sometimes it's called obedience, but it's also sacrificial, which means you got to give up something you believe, something you feel, something you want, and do what you need to do. Sometimes we can't just live a life that's just about us. Is anybody listening? That's selfishness. Is anybody listening? I think 22 is pretty cool, but 23 is neat too. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. Wow. And he was called the friend of God. Wow. So, verse 24 comes along, and it says this. So, you see then that do you see this? He's assuming that you just got it preached to you. You saw it on the overhead, that you see the truth here. so that someone can come along and tell you you don't have to do anything. Can I tell you something? I can't even get saved unless I do something. I got to receive Jesus. I got to get saved because I'm pretty, smart, old. You don't get saved for any of that stuff. You get saved because you did something. You received Christ. You had to do something to get saved. There was nobody going to hit you in the head with 2x4 and say, oh, you're saved. Huh? There's nobody going to come just say, oh, blessings to you, you're saved, you get to go to heaven. Let me tell you something, that's the biggest mistake found in the world today. You can't get saved that way. You got to be born again. So he makes a statement. You see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith only. Oh my goodness. So Abraham had works to what he heard from God that was contrary to his feelings and contrary to his plans and contrary to his ideas and contrary to his wants, and yet what he believed God said was greater than what he felt. Sacrificial. So two things we see here. Obedience that brings sacrifice. And it caught the eye of God. Now, if you have obedience and no sacrifice, you have a problem. Because anybody can be obedient to the things that are good, and you'll be called upon. That's where the test comes in, to be obedient to that which you put a store in. Or you know what you think is important. Is anybody listening? Now, we're talking about, I want to give you the pathway to blessings. We're talking about the power to succeed in your home, your finances, your dreams, your vision, your business, your ministry, your marriage, your children, your destiny, and your purpose on this planet. Oh my goodness sakes alive. And it's an unusual path that incorporates from verse 17, 11 chapter of Hebrews, right on through the book of James, the second chapter, 18 through 24. It incorporates two things. It incorporates obedience, yes, but sacrificial obedience. Now I want to show you something. I'm going to take you back to the beginning. You okay with me so far? You're doing good listening. Are you okay? Are you okay over on this side?
Yes.
I mean, goodness sakes alive, come on. I'm talking up here, you're listening. So are you guys okay?
Yes.
Just fell asleep on me for a moment, right? It's okay, okay, now watch this. I'm gonna take you someplace because I wanna show you the path. Is that okay? The unusual, no easy. It can be if you just believe and act, but it's not easy to sacrifice. Are you following me? So I'm going to show you the unusual path to blessings. Debbie and I, all of our life, have lived this way. I remember when this church was 250, 300 people. God spoke to me and said, you got to get out of business. I was making $500,000 a year. That was 30 years ago in business. He says, you got to get out of business and you got to go to work for the church. The church needs you. I was... had a basket in the back of the church, not this church, our old church building, a couple of buildings ago, hoping that nobody would put any money in it so the church would go broke so I could do my business. Because my business was like cool, you know what I mean? I had a niche going for me, I had it made. And God speaks to me and says, I want you to go full time with the church. I had his answer right off the bat. I said, they don't have any money. And he answers me back. True story. Give it to them. I said, what? I'm supposed to give them my salary so they can pay me? He says, yes, give them $35,000. You're now making $35,000 a year. I wrote out a check, put it in the offering, said, here's my salary for the next year, $35,000. Don't give it to anybody else. true story. Don't give it to anybody else. And then Debbie worked 17 years before she ever got a paycheck. Who does that? Who works 3 years without getting a paycheck? And so I put my own salary in this. And it was like sacrifice. I had to give up what I wanted, my plans, my will, for you. They're falling asleep on me today. I've never regretted it. Well, that sounds very spiritual. Let me tell you the truth. Most of the time, I've never regretted it. But personal self-sacrifice, giving of some of yourself for the betterment of someone else, is what this is all about. And oftentimes, you got to obey, and then you have to sacrifice. And a lot of times, we'll sacrifice if it's our thinking, our way, and our will, and our want, and it brings benefit back to us. It's so amazing, so important for us. Even in our giving, can I just throw this out at you? If you give to get, you've just violated everything. You give because you love God. God said to give. And then the getting part is whether he does it. You don't give to get. Never do you ever give. Anybody tells you give to get, throw him out. You don't give to get. It's not about how much you give. It's really about how much you keep. It's all his anyway. Is it not all his? So it's about how much you keep. And that sacrifice is going to have to come in with obedience to what he wants you to do. It's an amazing, amazing thing, but it opens the doors to blessings. I'm telling you, I'm so fat now. Look at this stomach. It's disgusting. Genesis 22nd chapter, let's learn the path. This you're going to find fascinating. Are you okay with me?
Yeah.
Absolutely going way too long. I don't care. There's no church service after you. I might just preach all night. Now look at you. Now you're trying to be nice and butter up, huh? Like Paul the Apostle preached so long, the guy fell out and died. You guys will fall out and die. Paul raised him from the dead. I'm not sure I have that ability. I just get sued. Okay, ready? Genesis 22nd chapter. Let's learn the path. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Now it comes to pass after these things that God tested Abraham. Here we are again. And said to him, Abraham, and he said, here I am. I always wondered what he would say. Is, I don't know where he's at, God. I have a feeling you're going to tell me something I don't want to hear. I don't know where Abraham is. He went somewhere else. Abraham's right there. Said, God, I trust you enough to listen to what you say. Verse number 2. Then he said, take now your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love. Don't you know when God says whom you love, he really loved him? Whom you love, and he says this, and go to the land of Moriah. And he says, offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains in which I will tell you. Let me tell you what he just said. He says, I want you to kill your son for me, and I want you to burn him to ashes. That's what a burnt offering is you take something valuable to yourself and you sacrifice it. So there's burnt ashes, nothing left, no existence whatsoever, useless, burnt to uselessness. Now, that is an amazing, keep in mind that Abraham never had the Bible, didn't know that God, remember how I said this to you? Didn't know that God does not accept human sacrifice. He didn't have a clue. He didn't know that it was repugnant for human sacrifice to our Lord. All he knew is what God said to him. He didn't have anything to go by. And the worst part of it, he'd waited 100 years for this child. This child was a child of the promise. This is what God gave to him. This is something he was so proud of. In his 100 years old, having a child, an heir that he could leave everything to. And here he is, oh my goodness, God. It doesn't say anything about him questioning. I would have questioned God. Is that you? Devil, get behind me. I would have run to Sarah. You won't believe what I heard. It's got to be the devil. Oh my goodness. He doesn't do any of that. And he, can you imagine the pain? Can you imagine the confusion? Can you imagine the plans just going out the window? All his future is gone because God said to burn it all until it's useless. If you have a child, can you imagine what that would be like? It's an impossibility. Personally, I have to tell you, I would say no. I'm not going to do it. Strike me dead if you want and send me to hell. I'm not going to do it. And you would probably say the same thing if we were honest with each other. But here's a man that was completely different and used in the Old Testament, New Testament as examples for us of obedience and sacrifice. Sacrifice that hurts. Sacrifice you feel. Sacrifice that ruins the future. Sacrifice that stops the plan. Sacrifice that's contrary to everything you ever thought. And yet he did it. And God will probably never ask you to do anything close to that, but simple sacrificial obedience. So let's go on and read. So verse 3. So Abraham rose early in the morning. Stop right there. Abraham rose early in the morning. He can hardly wait to do this. Like, what's that all about? I put myself in that spot. And God told me, you know, go burn Pastor Luke on the altar. Pastor Dan, I might do it, but Pastor Luke, I'm not doing it. You know what I'm talking about? I don't know. I'm going to burn Pastor Luke. Are you kidding me? And then to get up early in the morning and do it, I'd say, look, hey, Debbie, he didn't tell me when. Next year, next month, a couple years from now. This guy can hardly wait to do what God had said. How different is that than the church in America? Come on, let's be honest with each other. How different is that than the church in America that's waiting for God to do something for them instead of them doing their part in faith for God? It's amazing. He wakes up early in the morning and he saddles his donkey and takes two of his young men with him and Isaac, his son. Next part of that verse, please. B. And he split the wood in the burnt offering and he arose and he went to a place in which God had told him. Now watch this in verse number 4. And on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and he saw the place afar off, verse 5. And Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. And the lad, stop right there. You see the word lad? This is not a baby. This is not a child. This is not a brainless person. This is a lad, most likely a teenager because he carries the wood. A young teenager who knows things, knows about life, understands the love of his father, understands the security of his father's home, understands how proud his father is and how much his father has taken care of him. He says, and the lad and I will go yonder and we will, the lad and I will go yonder and we will. The lad, lad and I will go yonder and we will. The lad and I will go yonder and we will. First place in the Bible, the word worship is used, and the law of first use goes into effect. You will not see anywhere in the scripture where he goes to the mount and he sings a song. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I shall rejoice. Not one place. Let me define worship for you that can make you the greatest worship leader in the world. You ready? I said to someone one time, I said, can you worship the Lord? I can't sing, Pastor, at all. I said, I can't either, but I can worship the Lord, be the greatest worship leader on the planet. Because obedience and sacrifice leads to worship. And what worship is not just a song. We need to come into his presence with thanksgiving and praise. And then you come in and we sing songs traditionally in a church for a reason, so that you can get the world off you and remember who he is and remember who you are and remember the plan and the goodness of God, and the melody touches our heart. But can I say something to you? The deep worship he's looking for is that of obedience and of sacrifice that makes you one of the greatest worshipers on the planet. I don't care how good you sing. It's what you do behind your faith that makes you a worshiper. Jeez, guys, are you listening? And we will come back to you. Verse number 6, and Abraham took the wood and the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac, his son. And they took the fire in hand and the knife, and the two of them went together. And Isaac spoke to Abraham and his father and said, "My father." And he said, "Here I am, my son." Then he said, "Look, we have the fire and we have the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" The boy's starting to think. No way in the world he had a clue. This man had protected and fought for him and loved him all of his life. It's like there's something built in every one of us to trust and be obedient to our parents. Even if you had bad parents, you still love them, and you may not admit it, but deep down inside, that's the problem of the pain that you're gonna have to get through of forgiveness. But it's the whole thing here, it's on the inside. This boy never dreamt in a million years. Where's the offering, the burnt offering? I love what Abraham says in verse number 8. And Abraham said to his son, "God will provide for himself the lamb for the burnt offering." So the two of them went together. And when they came to the place in which God had told them, verse number 9, Abraham built an altar and placed the wood in order. Then he bound Isaac's, his hands, the bound Isaac, his son, and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. Oh my God, why are we reading this verse? Because God would probably never ask you to sacrifice anything like this. But there is sacrifice in your plans oftentimes for his will and his word. And we're learning that if a man can do this, how much more does that require us to do the simple things that he's requiring and questing of us as people in the church? I would have been, if I was Isaac laying on the wood about this time, I would have gotten the picture. My hands are bound, my legs are bound. My dad's coming at me with a knife. I would have screamed back, "Dad, I promise I'll wash the dishes every night. And I won't pick up my cousins at all. I promise to pick up my room. And I won't text during dinner." Anything. But he doesn't. God says something to him that's amazing. Verse number 11 comes along and he says this, and the angel of the Lord called him into heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." So he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the lad. Do nothing and don't do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God." Now I know that you fear God. Now I know. The testing is whether or not you respect God's word more than your feelings. What God's word more than your plans. The testing is whether or not you respect God's word more than what you want. Oh my goodness. He comes along, he makes the statement, it continues. And he says that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. In other words, the sacrifice of something you wanted. Abraham lifted up his eyes, and there he finds the ram caught in the thickets, and they offer the sacrifice. Take it down, verse number 15, after the sacrifice. Immediately after the sacrifice, watch this, verse 15. The angel of the Lord calls upon Abraham the second time out of heaven and says, immediately, watch this. "By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this thing, and because you have not withheld that which you love with all of your heart, or your son, your only begotten son, blessings I will bless you, and multiplyings I will multiply you, and your descendants shall be as the stars of the heaven and as the sand and which is on the seashore, and your descendants shall possess the gates of their enemies, and in your seed all the nations of this earth shall be blessed because you have obeyed. You have obeyed. You have obeyed. You have obeyed. You have obeyed my word. I stuck there for purpose. In other words, listen to this. Obedience oftentimes brings sacrifice that rubs you the wrong way, that brings, if you will, worship, and worship brings blessings. Now watch this. Obedience, write it down, leads to sacrifice. Sacrifice leads to worship. This is that deep worship. This is not just superficial worship. It's deep worship. And worship led to the blessings. It's an unusual path, my friends. Not many can do it. But the ones that adhere to it are the ones that get blessed. And God's just waiting to bless you because he loves you very much. And you're very important. But guess what? There needs to be some changes in my life as well as your life. It's not about my will. It's about his will. I believe that you received something today. If you received from God today, we'll give him a great big praise. Come on, somebody. Raise your hands if you heard from God. Thank you so much. Praise God. Nobody get up. Nobody leave. Let's talk. This one, Pastor Dan was saying, don't get up. When you get up, you disturb people around you and they want to follow you. We're sheep. We follow. Somebody's up. Oh, I guess I'll get up too. Last service, I was 10 or 12, stood up right here in front and got up. Man, I'm telling you, what I thought of them, I had to repent. I was going to, you know, knock them out. Right in the middle of the altar call. If you get up during the middle of the altar call, we're going to let you get out in the foyer, and there we have giant ushers that are going to beat the snot out of you. And then they're going to pray for your healing, which they do not do well at all. They'll just call 911 and say you slipped. So everybody stay seated. I want to talk to you for a moment. What makes you think you're going to heaven? You say, well, I believe in God. I heard someone say, if you believe in God, you're going to heaven. Oh, really? The Bible doesn't say that. It says your belief has to be, out of Romans 10th chapter, two words, unto righteousness. In other words, you got to believe God so much that it's going to change you to his ways, unto righteousness. Unto righteousness. I got to believe God so much unto righteousness. Listen, let me say this to you. Most people in American churches think they're going to heaven because they're good. Nowhere in the Bible does it say you get to go to heaven because you're good. Nowhere in the Bible says because you hope you're going to make it, you're going to make it. Nowhere. It's not in the Bible. Nowhere in the Bible does it say because you're nice you get to go to heaven. Are your mommy and your daddy told you were a Christian when you were a kid? Nowhere does it say because your mom and dad told you where, you know, you're going to make it. You're not going to make it. Somebody needs to tell you. Can I tell you something? Listen to me. Listen, at my age, I don't give flip what you think about me. I'm past that. I love you enough and respect God and you enough to tell you the truth. And the truth is simply this, and you got to hear it. You got to get saved his way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man goes to the Father except by me. You're not going to make it your way. Get off of your way. And what you need to do is be obedient and sacrifice, giving of yourself, that's the sacrifice, in order to be the true worship at this period of time in your life to God of yourself so that you can be blessed with eternal life. And you're not going to get there any other way. I might as well just tell you, we've watered it down in American churches for 250 years. Most churches in America say, well, if people want to get saved, they'll just get saved. Can I tell you something? Nothing worse The devil is working overtime to try to stop you right now. There should be a preacher in every pulpit working overtime to try to get you to go for God. And I love you enough to fight for your soul. And a lot of you that are in here, if you died today, you're going to hell, and someone needs to tell you about that, because this is not a game. And God brought you here for a reason, to hear the truth of what this is all about. And today is your day of salvation. Today, you're going to have to do something. Sacrificially give him all of your heart. Sacrificially give him all of your life. Can I say something to you? From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, what God is after in your life is a relationship of all or nothing. He wants all of your heart. He wants all of your life. He is jealous. He will not separate that. Everything else falls in place when you give him all of your heart and give him all of your life. If you have, a lot of people say, I know who Jesus is. Remember, we read the verse. Even demons know who he is and they tremble. You can't get saved because you have head knowledge about who Jesus is. And you're not a real Christian because you have head knowledge. Celebrate Christmas and Easter. I know that. But that doesn't make you a real Christian. What makes you a real Christian is about the heart. Have you given him all of your heart? He won't steal it from you. He gives you a free will choice. He won't make you do this. He's not a conniver. He's not a manipulator. He's not going to hit you in the head with a 2x4 and make you do it. He could. Guys, listen to me. Listen. He could make a trillion people that look just like you to do everything he wants and to worship him. A trillion robots type people. He doesn't. He made you unique. He made you a free will agent to make the choice. And before you is set life or death. Choose which one you want. And if you want life, then you're going to have to surrender your heart to the King of Glory. His name is Jesus Christ, who paid the price for you as a beaten, bloody Lamb of God, spotless, so that you can go to heaven and have eternal life. And then once you give him all of your heart and give him all of your life, you are saved. But then there's a progression of learning how to live as a Christian and learning how to be a man and woman of God. And that's why you come to church, to grow to maturity. So some of you in here, you haven't even started yet, and I don't want you to leave and die and go to hell. I want you to get right with God. You say, well, how do I get right with God? According to the scripture, Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. I'm a man. I'll see your hand go up. In a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go like this. 1, 2, 3, bang! When you hear that sound, bang! Your hand goes up, I'll see it. Then you put your hand right back down. How easy is that? You say, Pastor, if I raise my hand, hey, man, I'll be embarrassed. Uh-huh. You will be. It's kind of like a freaky little thing, but guess what? You'll be embarrassed. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than to be in hell forever, ever, and ever, and ever? Because you're more concerned about what people think instead of what God sees. No one is that stupid. Oh, foolish man, don't you want to know? Boy, we're all foolish, including me. But I want to know, and so do you. What's the truth? Cut the baloney. Tell me what the facts are. I'll tell you what the scripture is. Jesus said it. You must be born again. That means you're going to have to give him all of your heart and give him all of your life. Listen, that means you're not going to be perfect instantly physically, but you're going to be perfect spiritually. And then you work on the physical part of it as you grow in maturity in him. It's called progressional sanctification on that part. Today, here you are in a safe, friendly place. We've laughed. We've sung songs. We've clapped our hands. You were great listening to the word of God. I had to get you going a little bit. I had to fight for your attention a little bit. But that's okay. I don't mind. You made the old man work pretty hard. But, you know, I'm used to it. I'll go home, take a nap. And I'm gone, you know. And I'll be back to church tonight. And so guess what? Can I tell you something? Today is your day of salvation. Why not get right with God by giving him all of your heart, giving him all of your life, be born again, headed for heaven, and denying your presence in hell. Ooh, nobody wants that. You say, how do I do this? Get ready to put your hand up. If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, I'm speaking to you. You've never given him all of your life, I'm speaking to you. Come on, someone back there, I'm talking to you. Right back there, are you looking at me? Are you looking at me? You're looking at me? I'm talking to you back there. If you've never given him all your life, you know who you are. Today is your day of salvation. If you're one of those people that are not sure, make sure. If you're in this place, maybe you say, I prayed with Billy Graham, great. I prayed with Oral Roberts, or I prayed with Harvest Crusade, Greg Laurie, wonderful, great people of God. Can I tell you something? Praying the prayer doesn't get you in heaven. God watches your life to see what you do, or whether or not the prayer is even serious. There's no magical abracadabra formula of prayer that'll get you in heaven. It's whether or not you're gonna live the life and live to the things of God. At least want to. Come on, today is your day of salvation. I'm gonna count three, pop my hands together all across this auditorium. He says, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But he says these words, if you deny me, whoo, you don't put your hand up when you know you should have. He says, I'll deny you when the time comes and you stand before the Father. And there will be that time. There's no one ever, ever, ever escaped that time, ever since eternity, because it's the plan of God that you get right with God. Are you ready? Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one, two, three, four, five. Thank you. Back here. Six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Thank you. Oh, no sinners on this side. Okay. I really believe that. Let's go to someplace they're not lying. Six, seven, eight, nine, 10, back here. 11, 12. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? There's 12. There's 13. There's 14. Thank you. Now let's play with you a little bit on this side. You know darn well, sucker. You need to get right with God. You can sit there and stare at me all you want, but you need to get right with God. So you need to get your hand up. I don't know who you are. I'm not going to point at you, but you need to get right with God. You need to get your hand up. Anybody? Back to the family room, okay? In the name of Jesus, you need to get your hand up. Anybody else? Anybody else? There's 14 wise people. Anybody else? Ushers, help me. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Let's give the Lord a great big praise for 14 wise people. Thank you, 15. God bless you. There's 15 wise people. Here's what I want you to do. All 15 of you, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible. Now watch this, watch this. Those of you that are in this section that you didn't get your hand up, but you know you should have, you can get your stuff too and come anyway. Get in the aisle. Every one of you that raised your hands, get your stuff, bring a friend if you need to. Get in the aisle, come and stand down here in front. Listen to me. If you can say, I'm going to believe in Jesus, then put some action behind your faith that is righteous. That's what this is all about. This is a time of great worship to God, and the blessings are ahead of you, eternal life. You come right now. You come. Come, 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 come.
There is none like you.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
And no one else can touch my heart like you do. And I could search
come on,
for
come on, come on.
Eternity long and find there is none like you.
Come on home.
There is none like you.
Woo, come on home.
No one else can touch my heart like you do.
Isn't God good? Oh, they're still coming. Give them a hand as they come. Give them a shout as they come.
There is none like you. There is none like you.
Okay, everybody in front, put a smile on your face. This is a good thing, not a bad thing. It's like you're not going to the morgue, so stop looking like it. You're going to heaven. And it's a happy thing. Is that okay? Okay, here's Pastor Joel. Look to your left. See this guy waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. He's going to beat the crap out of you in just a minute. Are you afraid of that? No, I'm only kidding you. I'm kidding you now. I'm just kidding. Having fun with you. He's going to pray with you. I don't know. How did you say that? Oh, you didn't say the other word, did you? Okay, thanks. Thanks. Somebody has wisdom in here. Okay, he's going to pray with you, give you some free information, some free literature, and then he's going to tell you about a program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainers that'll help you get strong. He loves you. He's going to take care of you. No weird stuff goes on. Dan Roth is as weird as it gets, and I'm okay, and everybody else is, but Dan's really weird. Make a left turn. Follow Pastor right over there. Thank you, Pastor Joel. I couldn't resist.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.